I want to invite here an iconic company leader, Adobe CEO Shantanu Narayen. Adobe is a 36-year-old company, and if you look at how the company is driving innovation and has transformed itself, you would not believe it that it is a 36-year-old company. When Shantanu took over as the CEO in 2007, Adobe's valuation at that time was around $20 billion. And Adobe's valuation today is over $130 billion. So he has driven a major transformation, which has actually been studied by Harvard Business School, and there's a case study in Harvard Business Review as well on the transformation for the company. He's a very good friend, and I'm so honored, so excited to have Shantanu here to share his insights on driving this transformation. Shantanu, welcome. Thank you.
Thanks for having me, Sanjay.
Well, thank you for coming here, Shantanu.
Those are pretty cool shoes, I must say.
I know, and you get one today. And actually, all of you, because you are here now, this late in the day, you get a shot at it too. Now, I know they're very popular, so they may run out, but then you'll get some other exciting gifts too. So, Shantanu, thank you so much for coming here. We are so excited to have you. But let me just start a little bit with taking you back to your high school days.
That was a long time ago, Sanjay.
Long time ago, but I'm sure you have very fond memories, like I do of my high school. So your high school in India, in Hyderabad, Hyderabad Public School, has generated some of the world's top CEOs to do. You being one, Satya Nadella of Microsoft went to the same high school, Syed Ali of Cavium went to your school, Prem Watsa, who is Warren Buffett of Canada, went to the same high school, and Ajay Banga, CEO of MasterCard, also same high school. And I'm telling you, I'm not going to go on and on, because the list actually does not stop there. This high school has produced very many great artists, singers, and really world leaders. So tell me a little bit, what was so magical about this high school?
Well, again, first, thanks so much for having me here today, Sanjay. As you know, growing up in India, I think, you know, the big issue is always about education. And the school was modeled after the British public school system. And so I think one of the things that they insisted at that time was that you really have all-rounded education. You were required to do academics. That was certainly table stakes. But I think a big part of what we were all blessed to be part of was where you had to participate in extracurricular activities. You had to do a lot of sports, but it is pretty amazing. And whenever we get together, as you talk about, there's also T.K. Kurian, who was CEO of Wipro for a while. I mean, it is a pretty amazing coincidence, I would say. And we were actually all in the same school at the same time. What a lot of people may not know is that Satya, Ajay, and I were at the school at the same time, and Prem's father was our principal.
Oh, wow. Yeah. So you said all-rounded, and Shantanu is definitely all-rounded, because he is professional golf player, almost professional, right? Tell me what your handicap is. I know he's just listen to it.
You're not supposed to say that, because most people then look at your stock price and look at your golf handicap, and if they're headed in the sort of different directions. I'm a low single digits.
Awesome.
I thought we were going to talk about data.
I know, Sanjay. We will. I'm getting this is all important data, right? You work with your customers' personal data to deliver them personalized experiences. So I just want to make sure that they get your personal data too here, right? Yeah. I know your school's motto: soar like an eagle and explore your horizons. And you certainly at Adobe have helped Adobe explore its horizons and absolutely transformed the company, the creative, took it to the cloud. Tell us a little bit about what spurred that transformation. You have talked about reimagining business, reimagining Adobe. Give us some background to that.
Well, for those, and I'm sure hopefully every one of you is familiar with Adobe, and I think we're probably still best known for Photoshop and PDF, and it's rare that you have two verbs, you know, that represent what a company has been able to do. But I think what happened, Sanjay, was that I've been at the company 20 years, fortunate enough to be at the company 20 years, took over in 2007, and I think the DNA of the company, Chuck Geschke and John Warnock, who were the two co-founders, it was always about reinventing. You know, they created PostScript. A lot of people may not even remember that the first fundamental innovation for Adobe was being able to print what you could see on screen. Every time I tell this story, a lot of the young millennials say, what does printing mean? But we'll let that one pass. And then they build this incredible applications business. They build the incredible PDF business. And in 2007, when I took over, you know, it was like we started to see that there were some data points that said maybe our revenue growth was slowing. But 2008, we had record revenues. And when you're a first-time CEO, you see record revenues, and you're like, even I can do that. And then what happened was in 2009, as we all know, the recession hit. Mm-hmm. And when the recession hit, because our revenue was all, we had zero, pretty much, recurring revenue. We had 5% recurring revenue. And when you have 5% recurring revenue and you have a recession, people don't buy the software. And when that happens, you know, our revenue dropped precipitously. It dropped 25%. So we had a lot of these data signals. We had the fact that our revenue was not growing with the amount of content that was being created, because the amount of content that was being created, but people could buy one piece of software and then not necessarily buy, you know, more software. We could see that we weren't attracting new customers to the platform. The upfront pricing was considered prohibitive. And you know, people used to ask us how we were doing in some countries with respect to our software. And countries like India and China, our revenue was really low, but our market share was great because a lot of people pirated our software. So we had a lot of these signals that told us that unless we, again, dramatically reinvented ourselves, that we would not be relevant. And so we made two decisions at that point, which luckily have worked out. The first decision we made was we said we were going to completely move our business to the cloud. We were going to take a desktop perpetual business and move it to a subscription business. And we said that we were going to engage in this entire new business of digital marketing. Mm-hmm. And so I think both of those were moves that we made. It's easier to do it, as you know, when your back is against the wall. Sometimes it's harder. But you know, those were really the two fundamental transformations that I think have served the company well.
So what is the mix of the business today at Adobe?
Well, we'll be approximately a little north of $11 billion in revenue this year. And if you look at the way we represent the businesses, there's the creative business. There's the document business, so we call it the Creative Cloud, which is anything that anybody wants to do. You're trying to author for any piece of content on any device, you know, video, imaging, packaging on a bottle of water, newspapers, magazines, websites, mobile apps. That's the creative business. The PDF business is everything to do with automating business processes and workflows. And you can think of the enterprise, digital enterprise business is about 3.2 billion. So the rest is all the creative business. So that sort of gives you a scale.
So Shantanu, you have talked about using data to deliver personalized customer experience. And I'm sure the audience here would love to hear about your views on that. And you know, how are you using data in terms of customer?
Yeah, I think, again, you know, when we think of our transformation, Sanjay, and what happened was we used to ship everything in boxes. So we had a business, again, circa 2009, 2010, when we would create the software, we had a 12 or 18-month product cycle. We'd put everything in a box, and then we'd ship it out. And we'd hope that the revenue came in. And the reality was we had very little insight into what customers were really doing with that software, which features were they using, what was deemed valuable. And so we decided when we moved to the cloud that we really had to instrument the entire piece of software. So we got insight. Because otherwise, I think like a lot of traditional software companies, product management would sit around a table and say, what do you think people want? And it was one person's voice against another person's voice. And I think the narrative is important, but the data is really important. So as it relates to delivering our software and designing our software, everything today is based on, you know, what's the usage patterns? How are people discovering the software? How are they using the software? What's their customer satisfaction with the software? And so I think in the creative or the document business, it's all about using data to drive insight on what actions or what features people want, and if you can make it better. Let me touch a little bit, if I may, on the enterprise business. So what happened in the same time frame, in 2009, we said to ourselves, hey, listen, our revenue is not growing as much as, you know, the content explosion. We would go to New York, we'd meet with our major publishing customers, you know, Time Magazine, Meredith, Condé Nast, and they'd all say, well, Adobe wants to come meet with us, the CEO wants to come meet with us. I'll meet with them, but they had no idea why I wanted to meet with them. Because somebody in the bowels of the company used our software to create all of that content, but we weren't mission critical to them. And so we, and the other thing we told ourselves was supply chain was automated, finance was automated, HR was automated. Nobody had targeted the chief revenue officer or the chief digital officer or the chief marketing officer with delivering an enterprise stack that enabled them to engage digitally with customers. You know that old adage of marketing, 50% of my marketing's working, I just don't know which 50%. We said what we were going to do was actually use data. You know, how do you combine art and science? We were helping them with their brand, we were helping them with how they wanted to communicate, but we weren't using data for attribution. So the way we think about data is very different. In the former business, our desktop business, it's data we collect on our customers, and it's all used to hopefully deliver better software, as well as understand unequivocally, how did they discover our software? How are they trying it? What are the usage patterns? Because in a subscription business, if you're not completely on top mm-hmm. of how people are using your software, they're going to churn. On the enterprise side of our business, we don't own the data. We have drawn a line in the sand where we say the customer owns the data. So if a financial institution, if an automotive company, if a travel agency is using our software to digitally engage, all of the transactions, we do hundreds of trillions of transactions now on behalf of our customers. That data is completely owned by our customer. And there, how we think about data is, collecting data is, you know, it's table stakes. It's how do you draw insight? How do you, you know, make them have the ability to activate that data? That's the super critical thing. And that's where, you know, I read about all of your announcements today. You make it faster, you allow us to use more data, guess what? We'll use it up really quickly. And so I think that's how we think about data on the enterprise side.
I think sounds good. I mean, and we are definitely focused on making our solutions better, faster, lower power, to make sure that actually they can work well in the kind of infrastructure that you need That's to drive right. your business. So Shantanu, you talked about that, you know, how basically you get a lot of data, right? And enterprise, the data belongs to the customer. But you do get a lot of your customer data, you know, in the consumer world, that you are drawing insights from and supplying, you know, what the customer needs next, predicting exactly. it and supplying it to the customer. So I'm curious, all the data that you have, you know, pictures, videos, documents about consumers, what is, and you know, you are using that to provide customer experience, but what is your thought regarding opportunity to monetize that data even further?
Well, you know, different companies have different business models. And our business model, when we have a subscription-based business model, is we're not going to monetize that data, except in as much as we, you know, make our software better. Yes. But let me give you a couple of examples of how we use all of that data. I mean, there was the previous speakers, as they were talking about AI, which is such a big area of investment for us as well. The more images we have, I think the new strategic moat that companies are trying to build. I mean, Google does better search because they just have more searches that people are doing with it, and that actually enables them to make their search algorithms better, you know, the machine learning better and better and better. And so what we look at and say is that there are tens of millions of people using our products every day. There are hundreds of millions, if not billions, of assets that are being created using our product. If we can use that data to make the next person who wants to use our product and has a story to tell, if we can enable them to use that data better to, you know, tell that story, then we'll be better off. So it's used for our AI models. Our AI theory is pretty straightforward, which is we say we believe in domain-specific AI, so understanding images. We have search algorithms right now where you can upload tens of millions of images. You don't have to tag a single image. And if you do a search on that image today, you can actually send all of that. My team showed me this demo the other day. You can search for kid. And you know, this is tens of millions of images that had no metadata associated with it. It found all the children in the pictures. It also found the baby goats, because a baby goat is a kid.
Fascinating, absolutely fascinating. So when you look at all this data, all this content, images, documents, trillions of transactions, there is so much data. So in order to continue to run your operation and continue to take it to the next level for enterprise side as well as for the consumer side, I'm curious, what do you ask your CIO in terms of infrastructure requirements?
Well, the first thing is, you know, when we made this transition, Sanjay, it wasn't just about the product offering. I mean, clearly the product offering, as product companies, the product has to speak to itself. But the first thing we asked our CIO was, how do we even, you know, if you're trying to do transformation, everybody talks about people, technology, you know, and processes. And so we created this thing that we call the data-driven operating model. And for us, the data-driven operating model is, in a subscription business, how do you discover, try, buy, use, and renew your products? So how are people discovering us? Did they come to us from search? Did they come to us from social? You know, and so creating this infrastructure that allowed us in real time to be able to have a business process which allowed people to say, let's look at all that data in real time. And I can honestly tell you, it's changed how we run the company. We have a meeting every Wednesday. This data infrastructure is all real time. We're collecting data from, you know, different countries, different sources of where people are coming, how all of this applications are being used, and it all goes into this common. We're big partners with Microsoft, so, you know, a lot of this is in an Azure thing. But we're trying to activate all of that in real time, and it's empowered the individuals who are making those decisions to not have to wait for anybody in management to tell them what to do. If traffic's going up, they're like, great, how do we monetize it? If traffic's going down, they spend more money in search to be able to do it. So the CIO, the ability to run this real-time business and real-time infrastructure, I mean, people talk a lot about customer records and, you know, that's so, you know, I mean, who cares where this is stored? It's all about what you can do with it in real time. So that's really the push. And then the second one is, how do you get access to this data on a mobile device, on any device that you want, and get the insights? How do you do anomaly detection? You know, when some traffic patterns are different. And so I think the game has changed, where it's all about insights, you know, from the people who are using it and the real-time nature of collecting it.
Absolutely, I like that. The only piece is not that who cares where it is stored.
Okay. No. We want it stored, yeah. We want it safe, we want it secure.
Yes. I want to make sure you tell your CIO that it has to be stored in solid state drive.
Absolutely.
Okay. Yeah.
Our biggest asset is our data. If we can't store it securely, we don't have a business.
That's absolutely right.
Yes.
Store it, access it fast.
Fair enough.
And, you know, these are the kind of things that are absolutely big area of focus for us.
And, yes.
Shantanu, you have you're known as a product CEO, right? And you have talked about your passion for product. So share with us, how do you communicate that to your team? I mean, you have driven an amazing transformation. You know, you have taken the company from selling shrink wrap software to, you know, software as a service, cloud subscription model. And this kind of transformation in some ways is little similar to actually what we are trying to do at Micron, transition it from a company selling only components to a company selling high-value solutions. So just love to hear that how, in terms of driving your, you know, product journey here at the company, how have you driven it? How did you bring the teams along? Any word of advice you have here for Micron?
Well, you know, I think the first thing is I'd be completely remiss if I didn't say, you know, all of the success that the company has had, it's been such a team effort. So I appreciate the kind words that you're, you know, ascribing to me, but the reality is it's just been tens of thousands of people who have poured their passion. You know, we like to say we're...
But you inspired them well.
We like to say we're an intellectual property company, and our intellectual property goes home every night. Hopefully, they come back the next day. But to your other question, I mean, I think knowing what the purpose is of a company, and, you know, we talk about our mission being changing the world through digital experiences, and we know we have to do that through products. And so at the end of the day, even this whole transformation, Sanjay, we were so convinced. The business model was hard. As I said, I took over in 2007. In 2008, our revenue dropped by 25% because of the recession. When you move from a perpetual model to a subscription model, because you're not recognizing that revenue up front, your revenue drops again quite precipitously. So we dropped 25% again. And I was like, okay, I can shrink my way to greatness, right? I mean, you keep dropping revenue. But what we were convinced about was that we could innovate at a faster pace. And if you can, I'll tell you a story. There was a meeting that I was at. It was an engineering meeting. It's the Photoshop team. And they were all sitting and they were looking a little glum. And a new version of Photoshop was coming out in the April timeframe. And I was like, why are you guys looking glum? And they're like, there's this incredible new DSLR camera that's coming out in October. And we want to support that DSLR camera in October in Photoshop. I'm like, great. I know you're releasing the product earlier, and so why don't you release software that updates itself, and then you can input that camera. I'll never forget what they told me. They said, the engineering is trivial. We don't need you to help us with the engineering. We don't know how to deal with FASB, financial accounting standards, because we can't deliver innovation on an ongoing basis and in a bite-sized chunk. So you know, when financial accounting is determining what the product team is focused on, you're screwed. Mm-hmm. And so I think as a product person, for me, what can we do? I mean, I think you have to give them the permission to innovate and the permission to fail. And I think our jobs are saying, okay, if we are convinced we can deliver a better product, how do you unshackle them from things that exist? And a lot of companies are still in this model where if you're in a box software, think about what we had to do. You're in a box software, you're shipping products every 12 or 18 months. All the really cool innovation that's working, you can't talk about it. Because if you talk about it, you were worried at that point that people won't buy the current version of the product and they'll wait for the next version of the product. The side benefit of moving to the subscription, we can talk about everything we're doing and we can harness the power of the community in terms of people giving us feedback on what that product is. And we didn't fully recognize that. So I think in transformations, you have to try and figure out, what are the key things that you have to do? One quick thing, if I may. One thing I like to say, and I had to learn, in companies, when you're transforming, there's flag planting and there's road building. And I was more of a road builder. Maybe as an engineer, I was like, okay, I can do that. And I think I recognize that you go into a room and 50% of that room didn't care about the road building. They wanted the flag planting. Mm-hmm. And so I think in these things, in the product side, what I try to do is, and it wasn't natural for me, plant the flag. Let's go do this. We can deliver stuff on new devices. Everything's going to move to the cloud. Mobile's going to have the power. And so you have to do a little bit of the flag planting and the road building. But I think I benefited because I grew up in the company and I was an engineer at heart, that they still felt like I had credibility. And I think that helps you at the end of the day.
Amazing credibility and absolutely amazing results that you have achieved. And no question that it is about the team, and that's absolutely correct. But leading that team, having the vision, like you said, reimagining Adobe, you and the team, I think, did a phenomenal job in that regard. Let me ask you, you have also driven growth through acquisitions. So talk to us about it. I mean, sometimes some people feel that acquisitions don't add value, they destroy value. What's been your experience and what have you focused on in trying to make them work?
You're so right. And I think the first part of even driving acquisitions is accepting that, when you acquire something, it's not a failure. You're not going to invent everything in the world. And, I think even coming to terms with the fact that when somebody does something that's really cool and you believe that innovation's happening from everywhere, like you, when you have great brand and you have a great market cap, you're like, okay, Let's go, you know, get those people. We focus primarily on, we're not a company that takes an acquisition and says, let's drive cost cuts out of it. We're also very clear about the kind of acquisition we're trying to do. And we're trying to take small, nimble teams that have incubated new ideas and say, can you scale it? So I think having a clearer model of what we want to do, I think most acquisitions also fail, frankly, because you don't spend enough time on culture. And we have actually walked away literally at the last minute because we didn't feel like the founders and Adobe shared the vision of what we wanted to do. And so I think those are the two things we look at. Can we scale this business? Because then people want to come to your company.
Yeah.
They say, you know, we can use the Adobe brand, we can use the Adobe distribution. But I think the harder part is some companies even recognizing that it's okay. Google bought Android. I mean, you know, every company buys a couple of things. It's about buying it at the right time. And again, and I mentioned this a little bit earlier, accepting that some of them are going to work and some of them are not. And you know, for us, it's all about how many at-bats do you get. It's not about having, you know, a perfect record.
Absolutely right. I'm going to open it up to the audience for questions in just a minute. One last question that, you know, as such a successful company and a large company with a huge market cap, what do you think as a CEO, what do you believe and are the responsibilities to look after the community and the nonprofit part of the industry?
You know, it is such a popular thing right now. I will say John Warnock and Chuck Geschke, when they started Adobe 36 years ago, they decided that they would always give away 1% of net profits to charity and the community. And they believe that the stakeholders, certainly in addition to the investor community, employees, customers, that the community was a big part of it. And these were in the days when they actually had profits. Adobe was profitable from year one. We try to do it in two ways. I saw the announcement you made with the water, you know, very inspiring, Sanjay. So, you know, I think we all have an obligation. And ours, the way we look at it is, how can you mirror what you stand for as a company with how you can give back? In our case, you know, growing up in India, reading, writing, and arithmetic was, you know, the sort of keys to literacy and opportunity that you and I got. Today, I think it's all about access to digital literacy. So I know you talk about STEM. We like to talk about STEAM. Because the world without arts would be a very boring place.
Yes.
And, you know, that's what we stand for. So we have multiple programs. We give away tens of millions of dollars. But it's all about, can we get access to digital literacy to people who don't have access? Because we believe that somebody who grows up today without access to digital literacy is forever going to be disadvantaged. So, you know, we've had different programs. We have something called Project 1324, which is how do you get those people 13 to 24 to experience the joys of digital literacy? And so that's what we stand by. And the beautiful part about that is every employee, the way they contribute to that is by going and teaching in schools. And by giving them time to go do that, they feel like not only are they, you know, doing good, but they're doing something that the company stands for. Yeah. So that's how we think about it.
So Shantanu, Micron certainly uses your technology, your products. I'm sure, you know, the data centers that feed all your business innovation and business operations use one way or another Micron solutions as well. I think, you know, we too believe in giving back to the community. Micron as a 40-year-old company has a very rich history. And maybe there'll be an opportunity for our companies to partner together in working for the good of the humanity.
We'd love to do that.
And jointly, you know, go after some opportunities, address some community initiatives.
We'd love to do that. I think in the Bay Area, certainly, you know, the big issue that's up is homelessness and, you know, affordable homes and things like that. So you're right. I mean,
Sounds good.
This is...
So let me open it up for questions from the audience. Any questions here? Okay, yes.
So Shantanu, that's a great, inspiring story of how you transformed the company. Wondering, when you have made so much progress over the last decade through that transformation and you look forward to the next decade, what kinds of things come to mind in terms of, you know, the big trends that are going to shape your company and your strategy going forward?
Well, I'll talk about two, and I think it's a perfect segue to, I think, how we can partner with each other as well, which is certainly on the creative side, we just think the world's our oyster right now. I mean, if you think about what's happening with augmented reality, what's happening with, you know, animation, the ability for us to be able to consume all this content in real time, I mean, it's crazy that today people think that drawing with a mouse makes sense. It's crazy that people today can't talk to their computer and have the computer do, you know, take whatever's in their head and do that. So on the creative side, I think there's so much that we can do with that. But on the enterprise side in particular, we talk about these trillions of transactions. If you think about the first generation of software as a service, applications have moved to the cloud, right, Sumit? But the data has not moved to the cloud. And the data is still in silos. And if you want to deliver this great customer experience, how do you tie together what a customer is experiencing with a retail company in a physical location versus what's happening on the web versus what's happening in a mobile device? So I think a new data architecture needs to evolve as the central nervous system in an enterprise where you can get this unified customer profile that absolutely gathers, whether it's financial data, people talked about IoT data, people talked about transactional data. And the kinds of things that you announced today, if you can help us move that data faster, figure out a common taxonomy, figure out a common meta, I think that's going to completely transform enterprise software, because enterprise software today, companies are being transformed by a mobile device where they have absolutely nothing to lose and everything's based on that. So I think a new data architecture has to evolve in the enterprise. I think your leadership in terms of what you're doing to push that forward and how we can run AI models on that. We're incredibly excited. We just delivered a new product called the Adobe Experience Platform to do that. So I think these are hopefully just two ways in which, you know, we look at it. Documents is the last I'd say, which is we have, you know, billions of PDFs that are created. We are using AI to automatically figure out how all of those PDF documents could be made responsive on mobile devices. So again, as I said, and now I'll add, wherever you store them, however you access them, and whatever speed you provide, Sanjay, yes, I guarantee we'll use that and more.
I think we have a common agenda here, Shantanu. Yes. Any other questions? Yeah?
One last. There's one there.
Shantanu, thank you so much for being here with us. In your journey of transformation, you know, yours is truly a success story, but I'm sure there's a...
That's why I'm here. Otherwise, nobody would have invited me back. My successor would be here telling you all what a brain-dead idea his predecessor had.
But there must be a lot of challenges and failures you encounter. Is there any lesson learned you would like to share with us?
You know, I think maybe like Sanjay, I mean, we're cricket fans, and you know, when you're a cricket fan, baseball is something that you grow up here. But in baseball, think about it, and I guess the World Series is going on. You can go to the Hall of Fame batting 300. Why is it that all of us as business people have the expectation for ourselves that in business, that we have to be perfect all the time? And so, you know, people ask me the question a different way, which is, how did you take the risk to move your entire business to the cloud? And I say, we're paid to make investments. And as long as you get comfortable that some of those investments are going to work and some of those investments are not going to work, it's okay. So I actually mean it when I don't look at it as a failure. I look at some things as you've learned. And as long as you learn, and as long as you know, treat those people well, and that's what we try to do at Adobe, if there was a project that was not commercially successful, it's our job as management to go find them other enterprising and innovative places, because we ask them to work on that. It's not their responsibility. So I try to take that, which is like, you get very comfortable when you're in the Lifetime Achievement Award, you know, category. I'm not quite there yet, Sanjay, so congratulations.
You're well past
that. No. So when you're in that, you actually have so many quote-unquote failures, you just get comfortable with it, and you don't dwell on that. You know, and as long as you do that, you're okay.
Shantanu, thank you so much for an inspiring and insightful discussion. Really. Really. Awesome.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Shantanu.